Again.
The pilot experience from hopeless boy to a pilot. Go for it. Yeah. Why do I want to become a pilot? Well, first off, ever since I first heard of flying planes, being a pilot, I've always kind of thought about the freedom of the experience, not having to go to an airport and sit in a cramped, small metal box that's not really box shaped. And so I thought, if you're a pilot, you can fly all you want, you can fly for fun. So just the freedom that you could experience with that. Sorry, I asked you. Yeah. They're teasing. But kind of feeling of flying in the sky, with the freedom. Kind of explains itself. Good. And also kind of the rewarding feeling of, having a successful a general understanding of math and physics. Now, with this, it's pretty obvious that you're going to need to know that, because what most people don't know, some people do know, hopefully know, is before a pilot flies anywhere, commercial plane, anything, you can't just get in your plane and be like, let's take off. There's an envelope. So, think of it like there's a big graph, right? This is the weight on the side, here is the how long you've been flying. Now, the envelope is shaped kind of sideways, like so, and it has a point inside the envelope. If your plane's in the envelope, then you're good, you can fly. But if it's outside the envelope, maybe too high or too low, that could be, hazardous. Maybe it's too back heavy, and you're starting to slowly going up. You're going to have to basically fight it, flying correctly in a straight line. But here's the other thing. You can't just take off with your plane in the envelope if it's, towards the bottom of the envelope. Because if you do that, once the fuel starts going low, it's fine to get off. But once you're coming into a landing, the fuel's gone low and the weight is still there, that could cause it to become a disastrous landing attempt. So you have to make sure that your plane can start in the envelope and end in the envelope. And do it like that. Yeah. You also gotta have the principles of flight, which I kind of just talked about, and mass balance. Knowledge of your cockpit, your plane. So, most pilots know more about their plane than the actual people who are checking it, people who are fueling it up. Because most times, maybe you don't see it, maybe you see it, right before a plane takes off, the pilot will go out and walk around it, check out all the flaps, check everything, make sure everything looks good to their standards, because people are fueling it, you really gotta know your plane. Then, of course, you especially need to know your cockpit. You gotta know where the buttons, what buttons do this. Now there's hundreds of buttons in there. Now pilots don't memorize every button, but there's a few that they have to memorize, which are the ones that you're using most often. Maybe the seatbelt signs, whatever, maybe you gotta have the whatever, maybe, emergency lights, this, that, landing lights, comms, things like that. And nuts broke off or something. Shouldn't have happened. But you gotta know how to land. Maybe you don't have access, maybe your landing gear is broken. It's not coming up. You gotta know how to land a belly button, basically, just without the landing gear. Or if the motor went out in the middle of the flight, you can't turn it on. So emergency procedures, big one that you gotta know about. Hours. But out of the whole, you have 35. So apparently, I heard 35 hours for out of school. So, but you can—I mean, of course, you can have more than 10 hours solo. The more, the better, because you'll know more about playing, you'll know more about flying and stuff. So, now commercial, you're gonna need 250 hours to fly. Now. Those must be in like a traditional airplane. No, whatever. No helicopters, gotta be a real airplane. And that's the difference between commercial and airline transport. If you like, it's not just the same thing. Well, no. Commercial could be if you're flying a private jet for somebody, or you're flying FedEx, you're flying, you know, cargo. That's when you need 250 hours. You're flying airline transport, you're gonna need 1,500 hours, which is like a lot. Due to the fact that you're flying real people, you know? You're flying a bunch of people's lives who, once they're dead, they'll probably won't see you. They can't, because they're dead. They're dead too. Which is, yeah, a private or commercial license. Oh yeah, you also need a private or commercial license. It doesn't matter which one, but for that you need to become an airline pilot. Age and other requirements. Now for a private pilot, as I said earlier, you need to know your plane. Now at age 16, you can get your solo license. That basically means you yourself can fly in a plane. Nobody else in there. Somebody else is in there and you're breaking the law. And that way it's basically just your life on the line. And yes, you get at 16. 17, you get your private license. Which means you and one other person, you or more people, can fly. Now at 18, you can get like any license basically. You can get a commercial or, you know, airline transport, something like that. Usually for the airline transport, you'll be a bit older. So that's one of the biggest reasons why most pilots will want, most people will want to become a pilot. Now you could also become, you know, maybe you could fly it for personal, or maybe you're going on a business trip and like, oh, can I meet you in Walker? Yeah, sure, over here and over there. And you go there. Or just fly with your family. Well, who would want to fly with your family now? One good option that most people don't see is to become an instructor to other young pilots. After you become a pilot, most people, you know, they're like, oh, what do I do now? Maybe I should become a commercial. You just want to fly, you know, plane to get your hours up without having to spend a bunch of money. Becoming an instructor is like a great choice because not only do you get to fly a bunch of hours for free, you get paid by it for other people. the hours that students are logging, you get to log too, because those are basically your hours. Now, flying VFR or IFR. VFR stands for
visual.
Visual flights, which is flying without any, you know, flying without the instruments, without the instruments on the plane that would show you, you know, where you are and such. Now with visual flight rules, that can be very dangerous when you're flying, because if you get into a cloud and such, what it can get is vertigo, which is not knowing where up and down, side and left is. So you could think, oh, I'm flying perfectly straight, pull up to try and get out of the cloud, and now, IFR is instrument flight rules, which is basically like what they can train you with is like not even seeing outside at all, just really relying on your instruments, which is more advanced than VFR. Now, that would be, you know, maybe that way you can get vertigo with that, because when I get vertigo, you look down there and you know where up is, and you know not to die. And you can fly traditionally, just for fun. But with personal, it'd be the same thing. Maybe you need to go see somebody for some reason. So maybe you're not flying that fun, maybe you don't like fun. Maybe you're still like that fun. Now for commercial, I have FedEx, USPS, for the cargo, which is, you know, different cargo planes, different things, and, you know, it's a fun thing to do. You can also fly for the airlines, which get paid pretty well, actually. See that MO. But, with flying for airlines, you don't really have as much freedom as flying just like a small private plane because, well, it's autopilot. I want to see correctly. Now, another choice for commercial is flying as a push pilot, which is flying Alaska, flying around there, flying a place that's more harder to get to locations, but it's really flying people as tourists and then being able to land somewhere that's like not a runway or anything and show them that, all that, which is very fun. Or you can get a private jet flight. Now, everything that falls into the commercial category is anything that you fly somebody else and they pay you money. If you're a private pilot, you can fly somebody else. They can't pay you money or else it's commercial and you need a license for them. And of course, with private jets, if you want a private jet to go somewhere and they hire you to private jet them that way. You also fly for tours and for charters and yeah, also. But for the Air Force, I mean, it's pretty self-explanatory, but I tried to find anything that could give me options. I mean, I guess you could fly for the Air Force or the Navy, but those are kind of different branches. Or you could fly for the National Guard, which is kind of the same. Yeah. What do I think you should think about the ground costs? Well, first off, of course, the plane. It's very expensive. And that's what really gets, you know, most people out of, you know, just costs in general is what gets most people out of flying. You know, they'll pay for getting a license, getting their hours in to become a license, and they get their license, they're all happy, but they don't have the constant money flow to continue flying to get more hours to get a career or something in flying. Now that's where, you know, flying as an instructor is very helpful because you get paid for flying and getting hours. Now, of course, the cost of fuel, which not too expensive when you think of it for the gallon, but when you think of for a whole plane and how much that requires, it's a lot of money. So I would say that's also a really big thing that gets people off when they have to pay for fuel. And like it burns a lot of gallons a minute or an hour. Yeah. And of course, parking. You can't just land your plane and be like, No. You gotta pay for parking. If you have a little park there, you're gonna pay for a little hangar to put it into. And of course, maintenance. You know, every year there's a daily checkup or a yearly checkup. Yes, insurance checkup. And what they'll do is check everything. They practically take the plane off the plane. They check every little thing. They take off all the, maybe even cleaning. You know, cleaning is very important because if you're flying and a bunch of bugs get collected from the wing, well, you got to scrub that a lot to get that off because that can completely change the whole flying, the whole, you know, airflow going around it, and aerodynamics. And this is insurance. Check that, which is also expensive. And additional cost of repairs. If you survive long enough, you're going to have to pick up. Because you're going to hope that you don't have. you get like a lot of flights per day or stuff. You know, that's more what you find around Alaska or here in Hawaii. You fly around, people want to see the island, and they're like, oh, I'll pay $300. But that will usually amount to like $72,000 a year for those tier flying pilots. So they will get more depending on how many flights they get. Now, well paid commercial pilots can make up to $300,000 to $400,000 a year. Older pilots would make more around, you know, $100,000 to $200,000 a year. But that's the whole thing. You know, commercial pilots, once you get about like 8 to 12 years out there, you're able to get, you know, way more money than more of a senior pilot. Especially, it also depends on where you're flying. You're flying like transatlantic flight with a big wide body aircraft, lots of people. That's gonna get you more money per hour than a small little plane going from one state to the other state. So Air Force pilots also make some money, which is $100,000 to $400,000 per year, depending on how long they choose to serve and what they're doing for it and such, which is pretty cool. Yeah. Now here's how I remember. First off, flight simulators. I have flown a lot of flight simulators because I'm a little bit addicted to them, I guess I'll show that. And I'd say those more than I played other games for most of the time. And that's fun, but it also does help you get a lot more of awareness about what you want to do for flying and such. Lots of studying, sitting on the chair that is found in the bathroom. I'm supposed to be doing something else. And I sit down and start looking at, so what is it? How much is this plane? What is this helping? And that was really helpful. And I had a tad of experience when I got to fly a plane in Alaska back to the airport. Because I was like, yeah, sure, here you go. Let go. Now, my engineering aspect of how it relates to a plane. Now, of course, my personal project was learning about being a pilot and such, and also trying to bring my engineering, because I also have some love for engineering. Now, starts way back when my first quarter, which, you know, my mom was like, oh, see my mom. I'm like, see mama. I'm like, say pain. It's like, hey, hello, hello. Mama. She's like, okay. So, of course, she was like, very sad. I'm trying to say mom. She said airplane, ballrooms. Now, that was my first kind of feel for becoming an all-pilot and such, and flying, planes, just playing in general. Now, the paper airplane master, this happened when I was graduating kindergarten. Yeah, very different. Now, you see most people on their report or on their cards, you know, their graduation card images. You know, they got, you know, kind, caring, gentle. For me, I got the best paper airplane maker this school has seen. Because, you see, I would kind of rack up maybe a line or so of paper airplane makers, or maybe watchers, not makers, also makers. I'd sit here and be like, oh, what do you want? I'm like, I want one with the long wings, you know, and the bit of a nail curve, you know, tail curve, and maybe some, you know, some flash, and I'm like, oh, yeah, you got it, and then, so what do you want? Oh, I want the longer noses. And that became a fun guess. Now, the inspiration. This came to my idea of like what works really well as a, you know, thing as like engineering plane, but smaller, which came to a remote control plan. So I went along and started building on it. Now the programming was one of the fun parts, because also one of the hard parts is programming all the little things to be able to do the right thing. You know, some of them they'll be pulling the flaps up and down, maybe they'll, you know, program the engine to work on like this, that, you know, whatever the heck. And connecting that all to a controller, which connects two of them. The result, you're about to see that, right here. This is the plane that I'm building. It's not done yet. But now the whole thing with this is, unlike most planes, this is a delta wing aircraft, which means it doesn't only, you know, most planes, they have the front wings and the back wings, you know, things like that, the ailerons and the, with a delta wing aircraft, instead of having just, you know, the ones in the back and the ones in the front, you know, ailerons, this has a mix of both. When you're using your ailerons, it uses the ailerons like that. But when you want to use the parts that it
Questions?